it's a usable, experimental fulfillment center for the future growth of Kapoor. Whenever I was suggested, look, these, you can ask for much more, my guideline to the listing company was like, discount it.
Just a few more days before the IPO opens, what message would you like to give to the investment community? The floor is yours. Welcome to another episode of Market Insights Sri Lanka. I'm Naveed Majid, your guest host for today. Joining us once again on Market Insights Sri Lanka, we have the founder and chairman of Kaprooker.com Private Limited, soon to be known as a public limited company, Mr. Dulith Herath. Dulith, thank you very much for joining us today.
Thanks for having me.
So Dulith, let's start by talking about the IPO. Since Kaprooker's inception in 2002, I'm sure it's been a long and arduous journey to get to where you are right now. And as for any company, going public is always a key milestone. And I think on social media a couple of weeks ago, you akin this to getting your daughter married. So I'm sure it's also been a very emotional journey for you. So let's talk about the timing of this IPO, why you decided to go public, and also some of the key objectives of this IPO.
Okay, so yeah, as you said, it's been a very difficult but a very fun journey for me, because you know I enjoy building stuff. I'll tell you three reasons, primary three reasons. One is we started seeing a hockey stick growth organically. So when a hockey stick growth kicks into a company, you have to raise funds. It's kind of a no-brainer. So I had two choices: bring a VC in at a much higher valuation, etc., or just be bold and go public. Right? So I don't like to bring a VC or a private equity guy coming in, because I think they always think about exit. Right? That's all they think about, really. Because I myself is a VC sometimes, and what I think about an exit. So if I get a VC in, he's going to come and sit in my board, and all he's going to think about is exit, while at a board meeting even. Right? So I don't want that mentality. So therefore, my only other choice, not the only other choice I could have borrowed, but thought, look, if I go public, it's going to set its path on its own. That's second is the CSE's tax benefits that they offered this year was very, very attractive. So since we are absolutely on a hockey stick as well, that gave us a big reason, another second reason. Third is this has been something that I want to do for the future of the company. Look, I may be able to run this for another 10 years, right? Whoever comes next. It could be my children or other leaders, whoever comes next will not have the freedom to do whatever they want to do in the company. Well, technically, they can't screw it up easily, because then the structure is there and you are well monitored. So I would say those are the three primary reasons.
Okay. I want to move to the next question, talking about the 30,000 square feet fulfillment sector.
Mirihana.
In Mirihana.
Right.
So I don't think this falls within the scope of the IPO, but I would like to maybe share your thoughts on the reason behind this capital expenditure and how it's going to impact the future performance of the organization.
Yeah, it's not on the IPO, because we've already built it. Yes. We built it with our own funds. In fact, we are trying to open it in 3 weeks, so it's ready. The reason for this is we are drastically increasing our portfolio of products. So we are bringing in, we are heavily getting into categories like clothing, etc., that needs a lot of automation, a lot of warehouse low logistics level efficiencies to come in. So you can't really do that using our current existing infrastructure. So building infrastructure is key to any e-commerce organization. That's the primary reason for the fulfillment center set. Plus, we are experimenting a lot of automation. Now, we don't want to go 100% automation and bring all these crazy robots and doing all these things. You don't need that in a developing country like Sri Lanka, because you can semi-automate and that's good enough. But that too, fulfillment center is a vertical fulfillment center. So we do use a lot of gravity to just bring things down. So it's unique. You must come and visit sometime when it's open. So it's semi-automated. There is a bit of robotics and technology that we use. This will give us a great model to replicate. So we will be building more of these in other provinces of the country later. But right. So it's it's a usable, experimental fulfillment center for the future growth of Kaprooper.
So, Dulit, just dwelling a bit into the financials, so for the 7-month period ending October this year, Kaprooker has already achieved revenues of approximately 1 billion. So this means that you've already met or outdone the full year top line performance of last year, and you're running at a run rate of about 170 million rupees per month. A few questions here. Where did you see the significant growth come about this year? And I think there are a few factors that can attribute to this. I think the first one being a price factor. There's obviously the fact that we're operating in an environment of inflation, so there can be a price element here. Are you seeing a growth in the number of orders or basket values? And also, is the FX aspect also helping your top line in this case?
So there are three factors I would count. One is, Kaprooker has been increasing our product range. For example, the clothing category has been really, we are very gung-ho about it, and we keep adding more variety. So scaling up our portfolio and the types of products that we are selling is number one. Second is the organic demand for online has been, you know, skyrocketing, as you know. Things that people normally wouldn't buy online, people are now looking for it. Even furniture, you know, it can be ceramics, it can be, you know, any kind of things that normally in Sri Lanka people were not looking for online are being now searched online, and we are getting hit by those traffic, and we can see that pattern going up. You may think that, okay, the pandemic is over, is that going to slow down? Yeah, it's going to slow down a little bit, but it's not going to come to where it was again. So it, because it has created that habit in people, and then, you know, the habit, you know, they keep banking on it. The third one is our exports. So there is a project in the IPO as well about increasing our Amazon exports, and that has been it's been a trailblazer for us. So those are the three main factors that has really helped us to even overachieve the projections this year.
So Dulit, you spoke about the export segment, and we know that more than 50% of Kaprooker's top line is USD based revenue. Now, we operate in an environment where FX shortages, the issues are aggravating day by day. So I would like to know how having this export segment and it contributing for 50% of your top line has helped you to run your operations in a very smooth manner.
So Kaprooker having a top line in 50% top line in USD has been a tremendous blessing for us. We use it for, we are not depending on, you know, banks for importation help and things like that, because we have this reserve. And also, when I'm trying to grow our export business, like our the Amazon tea exports and those the categories of cross-border e-commerce, we utilize this heavily, and it's a blessing that we don't need to go and, you know, be dependent on a forex in this case. Yeah. And also, if you leave the dollars aside and just look at our expat customer base. So we have 1.1 million Sri Lankans who are outside of Sri Lanka that use Kaprooker. And that is something that we want to keep really growing, because if any in any developing country, there's about 10% of people living outside the country. And those people are, you know, heavy spenders, and they want to give back to the country. They have family in the country. So it's a different sector of e-commerce that Kaprooker has been always been focusing on from day one, which we can really grow after the IPO, because some of the proceedings will actually go towards improving such services.
Right. So Dulit, just talking about the valuations for this IPO, as investors, we look at the future potential of a company. Now, Kaprooker is coming in at less than 10 times in terms of its FY22 forward PE. If you could, and also you need to keep in mind that there's no comparable company within the CSE for Kaprooker, and in a global context, generally e-commerce companies tend to trade at a premium to most of the other sectors. So if you can just talk us about these valuations, how you came about to this, and also what sort of value is there for investors in this?
Yeah, so let me kind of brief you the thinking behind it in my mind. So I was advised actually much higher PEs on at the beginning when we were looking at it, and like 20 times PE, stuff like that. But what I said is, look, discount is as much as possible. Leave something at the table, because it's not about raising 500 million. If I won't raise 500 million, I could have gone to the bank. And this is about what's going to happen to this stock after the listing. So it was very crucial for me to price it right and low as possible, so it will take off on its own. Because, you know, there's 80% of the company at stake. Right, not the 20% for me. So it's very important to me that it was priced competitively, and that was always the thinking behind it. So whenever I was suggested, look, these you can ask for much more, my guideline to the listing company was like, no, no, just discount it. So that was that's organic thinking behind this. So it's less technical, but I think it will add value to your question.
Just a follow-up question on that, Dulit. So we're talking about the price to earnings ratio here. I want to just stress a bit on the earnings aspect. For the forward multiple of Kapruka to fall below 10 times, you're looking at significant growth in your bottom line this coming here. So if you could maybe touch on how you're seeing this significant growth in profitability, from which categories or aspects are you seeing this growth in profitability coming about?
Right. So in e-commerce, profitability really kicks in when economies of scale starts to work. Like in a brick and mortar shop, if I'm to double my sales, I have to open multiple outlets, right? So after 100 orders, if our outlet can handle 100 orders, I have to open a second outlet to handle 200 orders. But in e-commerce, that's not the case. You still have one outlet and suddenly you have 200 orders coming in. So there are a lot of fixed cost in e-commerce that doesn't change, but the top line keeps growing and the bottom line, so it starts to become a well-oiled machine. So I'll give an example. Let's say we have a delivery vehicle going from, let's say, Colombo 5 to Morotur. Now, we used to have a delivery every 3 kilometers. This is, if you look at 2019. Now, it has come to, we have a delivery every half a kilometer. So, suddenly from 3 to half a kilometer, same vehicle, same driver, same amount of fuel. Efficiency is 6 times higher. So that's how it really works, really kicks in when the beauty of e-commerce actually. So those efficiencies have been the main driver in the profitability increase. And you know, since we bootstrapped this company from the beginning, I'm very, very, my eyes are hawk, you know, always locked onto the bottom line, not the top line. So therefore we will keep increasing those efficiencies.
Understood. So Dulit, just a few more days before the IPO opens, what message would you like to give to the investment community? The floor is yours.
I think this is a stock that a lot of first-time investors who has never traded before would understand. Yeah. And this is also a category that has, you know, unlimited scope. Again, if you look at the market, is only 1% of retail. That gives you a huge runway in front of you. And there's only one or two players in Sri Lanka, even at this point. So imagine having very less competition and having this kind of a runway in front of you. So it's a nice opportunity for especially the first time investors who has never installed the CSE app to install it and try this out. And lastly, look, so Navid, if you buy one share of Kapruka today, I become responsible to you. So it's not like today where I just wake up in the morning and make my own decisions and drive the company. So I look forward to being accountable to every single shareholder. And it's very emotional. I mean, I started this company and Kapruka was a little baby in diapers, and you know, sent it to the preschool, to the all the way to the college. I bootstrapped this guy, and today it's ready for marriage, really. And it's a real emotional moment for me, because I know after that I will have less control. Because, you know, when you are in diapers, I can say, oh, sit down, do that, all that. Now, after this point, I'm not the only one in the game. You are also in this game as a shareholder. But it's going to be exponential growth after that in my mind. And that's the dream as a father for this brand that I have in my heart. So let's see how it works out.
Thank you, Dulit. And I think that was a great analogy for how you've seen this company through. I know it's been a very long and emotional journey, and all the best to you with this IPO. And thank you very much for joining us on the program today. Thank you very much to the audience for tuning in. I'm your guest host, Navid Majid, and we will be seeing you soon.